Lombardi said that perfection is not attainable, but if we chase perfection, we can catch excellence. Albert Schweitzer said ethics is the activity of man directed to secure the inner perfection of his own personality. Yours truly, Avi Klein, states that while the evolution of perfection may be a constant, you can't beat a great classic. Today on Wrestling With Anything But, it's my pleasure to welcome a true classic of perfection, the original Mr. Perfect, Jerry Stubbs. How are you, man?
I'm doing good. How about y'all?
Can't complain. I got my co-host, Dave Benedetti, over here.
Okay. Hello, hey, Dave.
Guys. Hey, how are you doing, man? Glad to have you with us today.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
There's some interesting tidbits that occurred in January of 52. Maybe a history teaching dork like myself is fascinated by it, but on January 52, Dragnet premieres on NBC, as did the Today Show. The British Army occupies part of the Suez Canal. The Korean War truce talks deadlock. But on January 1st, 1952, a New Year's baby is born into this world, the one and only Jerry Stubbs.
Yep. That was 1951, actually.
1951.
Yeah, September 1951. I was born Friday the 13th.
I was trying to do you a favor there.
Yeah, I was born on Friday the 13th.
I won't,
you know, it's funny
yeah.
because my son, you know, I graduated in 69. You turn it upside down, it's 96. My son graduated then. He was born in January the 13th on a Friday also.
That's, wow. And January, just when you think about January 13th and how uncommon that is on the calendar year, that's amazing.
Right, right. I must have been active 9 months before that.
Right.
In which city you were born, by the way?
I was born in Atlanta.
Atlanta, okay.
Yeah.
All right, funny. Yesterday I was actually, I wasn't really doing much. It was Sunday. I started watching some documentaries about cooking steaks, by the way.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
Yeah, and some of the best steaks actually made in the South. Yeah, they really know how to cook great steaks. And I was really impressed by some techniques that they have there that you can't really find in here, especially where I live in California. It's a little bit different here. Yeah, so.
Yeah. Are you a steak guy, Jerry?
I love to cook out. I love to cook them steaks, man. I love a good hamburger with a good tomato.
Yeah, yeah, sure. You know what it is?
I
feel like that's what I was going to tell you. I feel like that's the vegetation part of it is something that's kind of rare. Growing up in Atlanta, other than pro wrestling, especially for the fans listening here, what other sports were you interested to, either partaking or watching?
Well, you see, in high school I played basketball,
right.
played baseball, played a little bit of football. And we didn't have wrestling. I didn't have wrestling at all in either junior college or my high school days.
Right.
So I actually had to learn on my own and get in the ring and just go at it. I graduated in 69. That makes me about 67, almost 68 years old.
Oh, God bless you.
I've had a heart bypass. I had a four-way bypass, but I'm doing good.
Good to know.
Still making right. appearances, signing autographs, taking pictures.
Sure.
I have several events coming up. Got some in May and one coming up the end of this month.
Why don't you go in and plug that right now, actually? Specifically, if you know any specifics, feel free.
Okay. I'm going to be managing a guy named, let me see, because I have to think. Because Johnny Rich and Davey Rich is in the other corner. We got a steel cage match, and they
right.
called me to be in the corner of one of the other guys. Tell you the truth, I don't know who. I'm just going to be there. It's
right.
going to be at Meg's High School in Decatur, Tennessee, on the 27th of April. And then in May, on May the 11th, going to be in Dothan, Alabama. We have a fan fest. Going to be down there. Abdullah the Butcher is supposed to be there. Jake the Snake is supposed to be there. I think Orndorff may be there. Me, a guy named Dennis Gale. He kind of runs that area. Continental Championship Wrestling down around Dothan and all that surrounding area down there, Panama City, all the way up to Columbus. And we do pretty good down there. I've been kind of helping him out. I've been running a lot of shows down there with him, and seems like the crowd down there just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. This
it's a crazy thing, sure. I mean, it's one of those things where, I mean, it sounds like a great card. One of the things
I
find fascinating is the fact that the nostalgia aspect kicks in at such a strong level these days.
It is. And, you know, there's so many outfits out there now. You know, when we were back in the day, you only had maybe three, four big ones
right.
in several different states. But now you got several in the state. And you got some pretty good guys out there that can, you know, pretty much hold their own. Because I've seen several of them. We've had several of them to our shows, the new guys. And there's a lot of new, good talent out there.
Absolutely.
They don't get the publicity like we used to get on TV because they had to run them by social media and some things like that, podcasts and so on and so on. But they, you'd be surprised how much following these guys get and we get on social media.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that's the medium. When you were breaking into the business, out of curiosity, was this the fallout of what happened in terms of, we're talking about Georgia at least, when Ray Gunkel died of his heart attack, there was a bit of a fallout. I know there was a bit of a controversy when his wife Ann ran the promotion.
Right.
Were you around during that time or just a fallout?
I had just started in the business at that time with Georgia Championship Wrestling, NWA back then, and was wrestling a few times on TV. I trained with Rocky Johnson, who trained me.
Right.
And I was around Little Rock. We called him Little Rock back then. He was a little, about a 5 or 6 year old kid running around with us. So that's how long it's been since I started. And look what he is today. Never would have known that. But Rocky took me down to Griffin, Georgia a lot on weekends, and he worked me hard, real hard. So I kind of got to start there, but I went to school. Actually, I didn't go to school, but I was in the area of Robert Fuller, Ron Fuller, all those Fullers down there that were Welches. And Robert, I worked out with Robert a lot. And one day Robert called me and said, hey, we need somebody to work TV. And you know, back then I was policing. I was a police officer back then when I started.
Right.
And Robert says, come on up here. You know, you know enough. You've done enough. We've worked out enough. Come on up here. And, you know, work. So I went to work, and I worked with Nikolai Volkov.
Oh, wow.
He picked me up. It didn't last long. I bet I didn't last 30 seconds. But he picked me up over his hand, dropped me on his knee, and, you know, and I said, oh, good, it's over. Well, no, he picked me up again, dropped me on his knee, and I said, oh, God, please let it be over.
Right.
And then he picked me up the third time and dropped me on his knee, and he beat 1, 2, 3. But that was my first match. And then I had Harley Race on TV. I had the Anderson Brothers on TV. I had Abdullah the Butcher on TV. I had all the good ones, because I tell you, I told them, if you don't beat me, if I'm going to get beat on TV, I'm a police officer. I want the best up there beating me.
Oh, I love that. I love how you were able to kind of relay that. Do you feel like, especially back then, was the car the classroom on those road trips?
Right, yeah. It was, we traveled by car. We didn't go by bus, didn't go by planes.
Right, right.
Didn't do any of that until I went to Bill Watts' territory. And so on, and we had some long trips, and we did make a few on, you know, plane.
People talk about
so
those
on,
roads for Mid-South. Were they some of the most notorious in terms of just lengthy drives?
Oh, man. But they tell me they wasn't nothing like the New York territory.
Right.
They
yeah.
said that territory was really out there, you know. But
it must have been
long. Go ahead.
It must have been a mission, too, you know, the driving for so many miles, you know, from one state to another state.
Right. Me and Ted DiBiase and Junkyard Dog traveled for a while. Then it was me and Junkyard Dog for a while until I turned on him and so on. But I used to drive his Mercedes around. Bill Watts actually almost gave him a Mercedes that he had, that Bill had, to travel the territory. And Dog, he didn't sleep well. And he called me at 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. Hey, oh, he called me, oh, Mr. O.
Right.
He said, I'm going to meet you over at Foxy's gym over there in Baton Rouge. He said, let's go work out before we leave. I said, we ain't going to leave till 9. He said, nah, let's go ahead. I'm awake. I want to work out. So I'd have to get my stuff, get up, go to Foxy's gym, me and him work out for about hour and a half, 2 hours. And then we'd go eat a little breakfast, and then we'd be on the road, because it took a while to get to some of these places. We worked, when Bill watched the territory, we worked some twice on Saturday and twice on Sunday. And we might do 3 TV tapes on Tuesday.
Right.
So we were working all the time. There was the one time there for a whole year. I never got a day off.
And do you feel like in essence, when you look back in retrospect, was that experience something that maybe more or less prepared you for the trials and tribulations of other territories? Because it seems like once you were able to work Mid-South, not just in terms of the road, you talk about the talent, you talk about the experience, you talk about the knowledge. Were you able to soak in stuff like a sponge in terms of information and progress that way?
Yeah, that territory actually put me on the market, because I was with Ernie Ladd. I was with all those guys. Paul Orndorff, JYD.
Right. Wrestling DB number two was there, I think, too, right?
Yeah, wrestling too. DB Austin.
Yeah.
We had the talent over there. There's no
Absolutely.
Doubt. We run for 2 years and, almost 2 years straight and we had it. When I first went over there, I was selling $1,000 worth of pictures on a good night.
Right.
Junkyard Dog was selling $3,000.
That's incredible.
But then you know how the territories like to take your stuff over.
And that's
Bill
what I was going to ask
all
you.
Our stuff over
yeah,
and he would give,
you hear about
he would
that.
Give us a percentage, you know.
Of the gate.
We didn't have to buy the pictures. We didn't have to buy the gimmicks and stuff to sell. He did all that, and he'd give us a percentage of the sales, which, looking at them, wasn't probably about half of what we were making, but we put a lot into it by ourselves. So it was actually easier for him to do all that, but you didn't make as quite as money, but we were making good money in that territory.
And we're talking, obviously, about the 70s and 80s. One thing I wanted to ask you in terms of just Mid-South itself, do you feel more or less that you can only speak for yourself, you can't speak for the other talent, but were you guys aware of some of the TV and the innovative TV that was actually being produced back then?
No, we didn't. You know, we're finding out a lot of it now.
Right. Just so innovative.
And what's out there and
yeah.
troops are out there and all that, we're finding out now.
Sure.
I guarantee you, I get about three to five letters a month. That don't
right.
sound like much, but I get three to five letters a month. Some of them got these cards with me in it.
Right.
Mr. Olympia, and they're wanting me to sign it. And they always send me one, you know, to keep.
Wow.
And I'll send them a bunch of pictures back to me, you know, just for, if they go into that much trouble, I don't care. I'm going to send them something, you know. I always do that. A lot of times when it's some of these other matches and Dothan and all that, I'll take 100 pictures and, you know, I'll give them away. You know, I want them to have something. Bring it up here and let them other wrestlers sign it on the back. Most of them
will.
It's
a nice thing of you to do to give back, you know, as far as, you know, the fans. And I wouldn't say that they kind of butter your bread all the time because I know a lot goes into it in terms of, especially back then, a lot of the guys had to invest in their own product, their own character.
Right.
But
right.
Really nice of you to do something like that. To scale things back a bit before we get into the pro wrestling aspect of it all, this is now the wrestling with anything but portion. Growing up, what sports, again, were you interested in aside from pro wrestling? I know you'd mentioned that a couple, you know, you didn't have wrestling in your school. Was there sort of a goal in mind in terms of athletics that you had growing
well,
up?
I actually wanted to go into professional baseball. This was
right.
in the 70s, low 70s, when baseball – I actually went and I played in the rookie league, and I played in A-ball
nice.
And
wow.
with Pittsburgh. I played with Pittsburgh
wow.
for several
yeah.
years. But back then, right away, I went there a couple years, and the first baseball strike started, if you remember
right.
that. Way
right,
back
sure.
in the day. They had the strike. They let all the underneath guys go. They were trying to pay the top dogs. And then
right.
when it was over, they called everybody back that they wanted back, and they wanted me to come back. I was a catcher, and I played third base.
Sure.
And they wanted me to come back, and I was so disheartened because of all of it happening that I'd already had something in mind, and I didn't go back. I should have. You know, I'm stupid for not probably, but you never know.
Well, no, I mean, it's funny because the road less traveled, but, I mean, you were able to experience something that was a passion of yours, and obviously you didn't. You know, exactly. You can, in retrospect, you can't look back and say, well, it was a mistake or it wasn't, because all roads led to where they did. And I applaud you for being able to actually find a second career.
Mm-hmm.
And in pro wrestling, especially back then, as fans know, it wasn't necessarily something that was easy to get into. You couldn't just go to any old wrestling school and say, hey, I got $1,000, train me.
Right. No, they wouldn't do it. There's too much going on back then with families.
Yeah.
And other things that they didn't, it was hard. They really push you out. They didn't want you in there. I kind of grew up with Robert Fuller and some of them that was in the business, his dad and all them, but, you know, and then they went up and bought Knoxville, Tennessee, and I went up there, actually with my cousin, started doing it a lot. His name was Mike
sure.
Collins, and, he didn't want to stay in it. He got out of it. I stayed in it. I was the matador up there
right.
one time. And, and Bob Armstrong actually gave me the name Mr. Olympia. He said, man, you're pumping up, you look good, you ought to call yourself Mr. Olympia and go under the mask. So I did. I went under the mask and went to Bill Watts. And stayed over there, and then actually came back, built up more, and came back to Pensacola, and people wondered who I was.
Sure.
You know, surely they're going to figure it out after a while, but the majority of them didn't know. They say my eyes gave me away.
Right. Can you imagine today with the internet where they pick apart anything and probably find out within a minute who the guy under the mask is?
You can't hide nothing now.
You know, not now. But would you say that a big proponent, just in terms of just your regimen of keeping yourself in shape and nutrition, were you a bigger fan of supersetting or doing ISOs? Would you feel as if you plateau and needed to change your program a lot more consistently than anybody else because you were on the road and you'd probably have to sneak a workout here and there where you could back then?
Right. Well, over in Bill Watts' territory, believe it or not, Dog kept me up early and we always worked out. So
right.
We managed to get up. We were tired a lot of times.
Sure.
But we'd get up and we'd work out. DiBiase would come sometimes. Some of the others would come sometime coming through the territory. But we, just probably me and Dog and maybe a few more, was the only ones that really just were dedicated, you know.
What was your main source of protein after the workout?
Do what? I couldn't understand.
What was your main source of protein after your workout?
Oh, we would go, we'd drink those protein drinks, something Dog mixed up, man, and it,
right.
it tastes good at all.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's going to help you. And believe it or not, though, it did give you energy and keep you going. He never would tell me what he said. I can't tell you what he said.
Yeah. Maybe it's better off that way.
You put something in it, man. I know there's eggs in here. And
well, there you go.
Something. I said, but it don't look good at all.
So you actually weren't taking all those supplements and mass gains, powders, like a lot of these young talent they take today to get bigger. Yeah.
Yeah. And most of them, I ain't gonna lie, most of them, they reserved, went toward steroids, you know. And I ain't gonna lie, I took some Dynabol in my day, but I never took no shots.
But you gotta remember something, too. Up until 1988-89, this was legal. The other thing that, and again, that's what people don't understand. If it wasn't for the Ben Johnson scandal, who knows what would have happened. But the one thing I want to bring up, too, and this is the original source of protein, even for those who will have a budget and want to conserve money, orange juice and tuna. I mean, it sounds disgusting. Nothing more disgusting than that, I can tell you personally.
Yeah.
When I started on the circuit years ago, orange juice and tuna, cheapest way to go.
Vitamin D all the way.
Yep.
Yeah.
We eat a lot of tuna now. We eat a lot of tuna fish, and we also eat a lot of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
Right. And get the protein anywhere you can. Well, are you a big fan of, were you a big fan of starting, let's just assume that on Monday you want to target your biggest muscle group, which is your back, and just doing pull exercises. Would you dedicate one particular day to your back and then move on the next day with the second biggest muscle group, which is your chest, and just push all the way down the triceps at the end of the week?
Right. You always burn your triceps up, your biceps and your triceps.
Right.
You go as hard as you can with them. That's, you know, because you ain't gonna hurt them.
Sure.
But, we did chest one day, arms one day, legs one day. And it might be arms would be 2 days a week, and back and legs would be 2 days a week, and so on. We work.
Oh, you work legs 2 days, 2 days a week. I see. Wow.
Yeah, and we switch it off, But yeah, man, I tell you, we did it every day. Just about.
Was there somebody you were just fascinated with? When you went into the gym? Maybe you wouldn't sell it. Maybe you wouldn't exactly articulate it. But was there somebody that stood out? It just doesn't have to be in Mid-South anywhere that you were just blown away in terms of just what they would do in the gym.
I kind of kept to myself.
Yeah.
You know, I hung around with Junkyard Dog, and I kind of kept to myself because I wore the mask over there, and you couldn't get out and about with other guys a lot. Bill Watts would have a fit.
Sure.
And he was hard to work for. Bill Watts was real hard to work for, but,
were you receptive to more or less the Bobby Knight school of coaching that Bill Watts maybe, or did you...
Right.
Did you feel you wanted someone who was a little bit more, low-key? Which did you prefer?
Well, I've had both through all sports. You know, you get some that holler at you, some that don't, some that's easy going, some that's hard. Bill Watts was hard, but he was fair. He was hard, but he was fair. And he'd tell you, look, guys, you're in my territory. You go out to a bar, and you get in a fight.
Oh, I love it.
And you lose. Don't come back.
He meant it, right, though? He was actually literal.
Yeah, I mean, telling you, he was hard. He was hard on us, but he was fair, you know. And you mess up an interview, boy. Don't mess up no interview.
Wow.
And
wow.
Don't mess up no finish either.
Wow, that's incredible, Dave. Can you imagine working for somebody who tells you, "Listen, you're representing us, especially in the '80s and '70s and '80s, where our fan base is paying because they're looking at you because they know you're tougher than they are. They want to vicariously live through you. But if you go to a bar and some of these guys step up to you and you can't take care of business, I'm going to fire you." You imagine the pressure on that? I mean, that's just incredible.
Oh, yeah. I've seen some good fights in the dressing room.
Wow.
Yes,
in-house.
Bill Watts, yeah. you'd get a guy that's starting out, he'd go out there and he'd mess up something terribly. And he'd tell Orndorff, "Hey, he messed your match up and he made you look like crap.
Sure.
What you gonna do about it?"
Right.
Orndorff going there and just beat the crap out of these people.
Orndorff tells a great story that when he went to Mid-South first, he couldn't quite find his way yet, quite find his footing, and Bill Watts just gave him that pressure. He goes, "Look, I know you have a kid coming, I know, but if you're not gonna work the way you need to, then you're out." And like, he sort of would motivate people to either, just like you said, succumb under the pressure or rise above it in that territory. So,
right. I mean, he'd tell you, too, if you had to go to a funeral, said they already passed away, what do you need to go for?
Wow. Right.
Yeah. I got you booked in the semi-main event. I need you in my territory, and you're going to miss two or three main events.
Sure.
So on. Do you want to work, or do you want to just go home?
Right.
He was looking for discipline, pretty much. He was looking for discipline, dedication. I would say, like, he wasn't really micromanaging you. He just wanted everything for your own benefit, pretty much. That's what he
did. He wanted it his way and his way only. And
right.
Junkyard Dog had a kind of a free hand, but he's about the only one. Him and Ernie Ladd taught hell from Bill Watts all the time.
Right.
You know, Ernie would book some and Bill would fire him. He would book some, he'd fire him again.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Same thing with Grizzly Smith. He did him the same way. Jake the Roberts, you know, is Grizzly Smith's son.
Sure.
And he do Grizzly Smith the same way. Them poor men out there, they had a hard time. And I worked a lot with Ernie Ladd, you know. And he hit you, he'd look like he never hit you, boy. But them big old hands he had was like Andre's.
Right.
He came down
right.
And you could feel it. You feel it.
Brad Armstrong, talks about working with Ernie up there in Mid-South. I actually believe you won the title from at one point, and it was just as you described it. People, I don't think, really give a lot of credit or really remember how big Ernie Ladd was.
Oh, he was huge.
Literally and figuratively.
Yeah, he was huge. I worked with a lot. One-man gang.
Yeah, George
Gray. I had a lot of those, man.
Yeah.
Back in the day. I even worked against me and another guy when I was kind of starting out. We worked against Andre the Giant.
Right.
Know? That was back in my early days, you know. My eyes, you know, going at that man like that. He steps over the rope and he looks at us. And I look at my partner and I'm going to say, "You go ahead. I'll be right behind you."
And is it just, and people, again, not just height-wise or just mass, but he was a specimen. When you looked at Andre the Giant, he was a specimen.
Oh, yes. And let me tell you a story.
Yeah.
About Andre, since we're on it. We got time?
Yeah. We have a lot of time. Yep.
Okay. Andre, let's see, it was, who was booking? Somebody was booking in Georgia then. I think it was, Ole Anderson.
Right.
Ole calls, I got a van, right? Me and Randy Rose was going to Rome, and we were on that card, and so was Andre the Giant. He said,
right.
How about, I'll pay you if you'll let Andre ride with you and take him up there and bring him back to the hotel when you get through. So I said, oh, sure. I gave him a ride. You don't even have to pay me. But when we got up there and we got finished and we come home, he said, "Okay, boys, I'm going to buy the beer. Stop at the beer store. I'm going to buy a beer." So we stop at the beer store, right?
Right.
So he gets him a case. And me and Randy just get a six-pack to split.
Right.
So we go on down the road, and we've been on down the road maybe 45 minutes. He hollers, "Oh, I need more beer. I need more beer." I said, "You done drank all that beer?" "Oh, yeah, I need more beer. Stop up here at the store. Get me more beer." So we stopped, and he said, "Y'all want something?" I said, "No, we're fine." So we get on down past Atlanta and on down to around Haverhill, down around the airport where he's staying, and he says, "Oh, I'm hungry. I said, "Let's stop at the yellow place." And I'm saying,
right.
Man, I'm trying to think. Yellow place. So Randy says, you think he's talking about the Waffle House? I said, Waffle House, right? Waffle House. Oh, yeah, Waffle House. So we go in the Waffle House, and everybody's eyes are big, you know.
Andre the Giant's walking in there, and he's ready to eat.
So we go in there, and the waitress comes over there, and she says, okay, can I help y'all? Andre said, you'll get what you want. You get. Okay, so we got a normal plate, you know, scrambled eggs and cheese and whatnot. But
right.
And then she said, what would you like, sir? He says, those eggs. She said, those eggs up there in that basket. He said, yes, those eggs. You scramble, you keep coming. You scramble, you keep coming. He said, and she said, well, you want hash browns with that? He said, yeah. Scramble, do that. Scatter my hash brown. Bring me some of them. Just keep them coming.
Wow.
So,
Jerry, what I'm picturing, I have to interject, what I'm picturing is almost like those toy factories where they just keep making toys and
well,
shoveling down the line. I mean,
well, man, and I guarantee you there had to be at least 3 to 4 dozen eggs.
Oh, my goodness.
At least. And I looked at Manny and I said, Manny, I said, I'm glad I ain't going to his room. You know.
Did you guys get out there at 4 a.m.?
One of them little stories, you know, that you can tell. It's really, it is true. It's a true story.
But you know what sticks out, Jerry? What sticks out is that I like to be intuitive and listen to the little details, and I like the fact that you had mentioned he actually said to you guys, order whatever you want, almost if it was on him, like he was pretty much treating you guys.
Oh, yeah. And Ric Flair. Ric Flair is another one. Now, you go into a bar, a bunch of guys sitting there, he would always get a whole tray of kamikazes.
Right.
And have the waitress bring them over to all the boys.
Yeah.
Yeah, always. Any bar I ever was in after I worked on a match,
that's incredible.
An event that he had, it always. If he came in there, he's going to set the boys up.
Treat everybody up. For someone who has such an extensive background in athletics as you do, do you feel as if right now, maybe something that's lost as far as the art in sports is the camaraderie aspect of it all? Because as society moves forward, or some might say backwards, as we progress or regress, depending on your point of view, now that there's agents in locker rooms and managers and sponsorship and we have networks everywhere and social media, in a way it sort of creates an automatic division amongst teammates. Do you feel like back then you were fortunate to be blessed in an era where camaraderie was at a premium?
Right. Yeah, we were. It's not like that today. I mean, it's nice out there. You got a lot of young talent. They up and down, up and down. They don't draw no picture. They don't,
no Instagram
into it, you know. The crowd's just watching them do acrobatic stuff, most of them.
And
they can do that. I mean, they're good at it. But that's not what it's all about. You have a good guy and a bad guy. And when the two good guys go out there and wrestle each other, people didn't like it.
Scale things back a bit in terms of just the non-wrestling aspect of it. We like to rotate back and forth. Growing up, what kind of music were you into, and is it still sort of the same taste? Or has it changed over the years?
Well, I always liked country music, but I wasn't into much music until I got over there with Junkyard Dog, and he played, that one. And I went out to the ring with him a lot of times with that one, and then that kind of music kept coming. Randy Savage had his stuff, and people just started using ballets and music stuff. So it was kind of way past halfway in me in the business before all the music came out, you know.
Was it amazing to see the evolution of music playing such a big pivotal role in professional wrestling?
It depends on the music that you come out with.
Yeah.
As soon as they hit that music, it's just like a TV show coming on Saturday morning. They had some sort of music that started it off. You'd be in the kitchen and say, hey, I got to go.
Oh, that's a good point. I like how you put that. That's a really good point.
Wrestling's coming on. I got to go. You know, I'll call you back later. I got to go.
Yeah.
You know, they knew that. They identified that program with that music. And
right.
They would do you the same way if you had music and they started your music. They knew, oh, boy, here he comes.
I never thought of it that way. That makes perfect sense. Yeah,
it just identified you with the music. And like Bob Armstrong's used Bad to the Bone.
Right.
You know, they loved that. They knew when they heard that Bob Armstrong was coming.
Sure. Sure.
You know. So
what about
it helps. I think it kind of helps a little bit. For the wrestler, you know, to have a good song, a good music, a good tune.
The worst thing to do is when they if you have a great theme, and then I guess today the fans aren't as patient as they used to be, where they'd give a performer at least a little bit of leeway, the match that wasn't up to standards, and the theme music a lot of times regardless of whether the performer works well in the ring or has an audience behind him or not, that theme music sometimes can remain iconic and help the profile of the professional wrestler in the long run.
Right, yeah. I think the music actually helps a lot. You know, it identifies them with the wrestler or the program or the event or something that's going on. It comes on. You see ESPN, they have a little music come here. Other sports, they have it.
Right.
But I wasn't into music until way over a little halfway in my career.
Later on.
You know.
Were you,
I didn't need it at the time because I was coming out with Junkyard Dog. And Skandal Akbar, what a great manager.
Sure.
I'm telling you.
Sure.
I mean, some of those were just great back then.
I mean, it was an amazing. Yeah, go ahead.
Did you miss American music and everything that America has to offer during your time in Japan?
Yes, I loved going to Japan. I went 4 or 5 times a year, and the most I went was 4 weeks at a time, and the least I went was 2 weeks. I liked the 4 weeks, but it's hard going 4 weeks, man. You get tired of being over there.
Yeah, that's right. It's a long flight. It can be overwhelming, and
Was the culture shock? Was the culture shock very impactful?
No, it wasn't. You would see these kids, I tell you, they couldn't be more than 12, 13 years old, and you see them in a lot of these different arenas, and you say, how'd you get here? Me ride train. And they would show up by themselves, no parents or nothing, and
that's
they
incredible.
Would sign them autographs. Because over there, you could work a match tonight, and the book would be out tomorrow.
Right.
And they would call your hotel room. Can I come get signed? Can I come get signed? Yeah, come on up here, I'll sign it.
And you hear a lot about the fans over there who were a bit submissive, even if the great stories of the late, Frank Gotish and Bruiser Brody, Abdullah, and they would just literally almost be honored to get attacked by a heel if they were in their way. I mean, the mentality was so different. Yeah.
That's right. Yes. Yes, sir.
It was such a way to look at it. But, and the other thing, too, I guess, about Japan that I find interesting is the fact that a lot of the guys that wrestled over there, say, especially back then, they preferred that there was a no-nonsense approach. Crisp bills at the end of your tour, in an envelope, no shenanigans, no promoters. And, again, we're not throwing names under the bus. We don't do that here. We talk all about positive energy. But did you ever come across nameless promoters that, I guess, in the States or even abroad that kind of were a pain in the butt to deal with?
No, I didn't. I guess I was, kind of in with most of them, just kind of, I did what they wanted me to do. And so on, but I never had any problem with any promoters.
So
Ron Fuller was a good one. He was
a
good promoter. Bill Watts was good. He just hard.
Right.
And so on. And shoot, I worked for Ole. Now, Ole was hard to work for, too.
Was Ole similar to Bill Watts in terms of their philosophy or no?
Yeah, he was a smart ass,
Yeah.
He could be a smart ass.
Sure.
And he thought that was cute,
Right.
But, it didn't bother me because I knew that was his personality and that's the way he acted. It didn't bother me, So, but I appreciate everybody, all the promoters out there that gave me a chance and so on to get me where I am.
This is a random question.
I had a chance to go to New York, and work up in New York with Arn Anderson, but I developed a blood clot. And I was going to be the only masked wrestler up there when Arn went up there. Me and him was going there. Flair was bringing us up to New York with Vince.
Wow.
And Arn went. I couldn't go. I had to go to the hospital. I had a blood clot that broke off and went through my heart and landed in my lungs.
Wow.
Which I was lucky then, And then I was out for a long time, over a year.
That's something a lot of people don't necessarily even know. I mean, so just to stick on this a little bit, to piggyback off of what you said, it was almost imminent where you were going to go up north and work for, was it Vince Jr., I'm assuming, not Cena.
Right, yep.
And was this already set up? Was it something?
My finish was going to be a drop kick off the top rope.
Look at that.
Mm-hmm. Today, though, I don't think.
Not many can. Did you feel like, that is my follow-up question, did you feel like your mentality at that point was, I'm going to get myself better and get back up there, or didn't necessarily, wasn't that really not on your radar?
Well, that's when everything started to break, Right. Territory started to fold. Everybody, Vince was getting all the good talent and all that, and some of the territories just folded up, you know.
Right.
So
right.
Then it was hard to get something going, you know. There was some outlaw groups, we call them, and did okay. And finally, I just said, nah, going back to the police department.
Sure.
So
I
left there, Pensacola. I went, moved to Atlanta, got a police job back in, 93. Stayed there till 99 and, just kind of started working outlaw groups and so on and working with Dennis down in Dothan, Alabama and just taking pictures and going signing autographs and things, you know.
Jerry, you were part of, to get the scale back, we're going to rotate back between wrestling and other events in life, but you were actually part of an interesting time in terms of your era. What was the mentality of the people that were around you growing up during the draft for the Vietnam War?
I don't really remember. I know that I was good sometime and I was bad sometime. You know,
right.
When I was bad, they'd hate me, throw things at me, spit at me, and all that stuff. But when I went to leave the arena, they was all out back wanting to talk to me.
Right.
You know, and I had some old ladies, man. When I was bad, I was bad. I'd get on the mic and I'd call some of them out that's in wheelchairs and things like that. I get back, man, they say, you bad.
Right.
You bad. I had one guy, one lady that was on an air tank. She sat on the corner every week. She got on me every week.
That's interesting.
So finally I got the mic one night and I said, hey, if you don't hush your mouth and quit hollering at me, I'm going to come out there and I'm going to take that tank away.
Wow.
And then you're going to really feel it. And then
right.
This guy, this crippled guy in the other corner got him in. Man, he would give me hell. And I said, okay, I had enough from you too. Why don't you stand up and say that?
You can't manufacture that type of heat. I mean, it's organic, and that's what makes it so interesting. I mean, especially today where a lot of people might say it's harder to get that heat from fans, but it is.
It's hard to get it now because all they do is hot spots.
Sure, sure.
You know, they don't tell that story and get that heat where that bad guy's whooping that good guy and them people out there hollering for that good guy. They can't stand him getting beat up like he is.
What
you know, when that good guy starts whooping you, it's a different story, man. They go wild.
Of course. What TV and films do you remember growing up? Were you a TV and film guy? You were part of the era where the TV was almost like it was known as a babysitter because during that particular point in time, it was still a very innovative invention. Were you into, like, TV shows and movies growing up?
Oh, yes. I'd watch Joe Pedicino. He had a program to come on in Atlanta. He would have probably 10, 12 wrestling shows.
Right.
You know, and ours came on between 2 and 4 sometimes. But, yeah, I had people say, man, I stayed up and watched that. I wish they'd put y'all on a better time. And so on and so on. I said, man, I stayed up, too. Stayed up and watched it. I was trying to see what my mistakes was so I could clear it up.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And they said, man, but we always stay up. We got a bunch of us, the rowdy people that just stayed up and watch.
Any particular movie stick out that you went to, I guess as a kid or a teenager, to a movie theater that came out at that time that still resonates with you? Favorite movies?
I remember the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Classic. Yeah.
I was working down that way and with Bill Watts, and we'd work in some in Texas territory, you know, and I was over there with Fritz and them.
Right.
And, we were down in San Antonio, and that picture came out, and it's like me and Moondog Maine.
Incredible.
And two more. We went to watch it. You know, first thing I said, let's go watch it. That's supposed to happen around here or something, you know?
That's incredible. Was there a buzz? Was there a buzz going around at the time about the movie?
Do what?
Was there sort of like a buzz? People were talking about, oh, is this really based on something that happened? Was there sort of like a buzz? Yeah.
It was, you know, it was wild too, man.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it, but that's about the only one that we didn't have time to do too much.
Of course.
Dog would have me in the gym in the daytime if we had any time. So we couldn't go to the movies and then take off and go to the matches, you know. So we had to drive so far.
A lot of the guys said that, you know, in terms of just sometimes movies or a book, they could draw inspiration for the character. But here's the catch-22. The catch-22 is, as you mentioned, a lot of times it's car, hotel, or motel, get some dinner, get some food, to the gym, to the show, and rather rinse, repeat.
Right. And when we go in the dressing room, we play games, cribbage.
Right.
We play cards, you know, different things. Same thing in Japan when you're on them buses. You get a little VCR, you can watch a movie on your bus. But
sure.
We play cards. We play cribbage and other games, you know.
Sure.
Did you consider... And then, too, here's something, too. If you, you didn't get the food that you want from America and you go to Japan, right? It's not the same.
Sure.
So if you've seen a big boy, Shoney's Big Boy, a McDonald's or something that's American style, oh, man, you all hear the whole bus. Stop this you-know-what bus.
All of a sudden, you don't take for granted that Big Mac or anything, yeah.
And a Japanese boy saying, no, can't stop. I'll sketch you. And I was Road Warriors and Terry Funk one time, and Terry Funk slapped him in the back of the head and said, didn't we tell you to stop?
Right.
He said, okay, Mr. Funk. So we stopped, and we'd eat. That's about the only time a Big Mac over there cost you $5 when I was going. It's probably more now.
Incredible.
Yeah.
It was good.
What were your experiences working with Mike Stallings?
Mike was my cousin and we played ball together growing up, little league and so on. And so we were just like brothers instead of cousins.
Right.
And Mike taught me a lot, but he did go to school with Robert Fuller. He did go to school with him. And I just fell right in because I played ball and with all of them during things, and it just one thing led to another, and I fell right in, you know. And back then, you wasn't making much as a police officer.
I was going to tell you, a lot of athletes, even back then in other sports, you'd hear up until even, and this is another thing I wanted to ask you, of course, being raised in Atlanta, a lot of athletes said that they didn't really, they had to have a second job just to support themselves, even in the four or five major sports in the States. Being in Atlanta, did you ever get a chance to watch or hear of, or just, maybe watch it on TV or a game, watch the great Pistol Pete, the late Pistol Pete?
Oh, man, yes. I saw him in Louisiana.
Right, LSU,
yeah,
right?
I got to see him when he was playing for LSU. I didn't want him for LSU.
Yeah, LSU, he played for his father.
He was tough, man. He could dribble. He could really dribble.
Wow.
So I got to see him in person, I think, a couple times down there.
Was he really all that they made him out to be? Because there's so little footage of him. That's why I ask.
You would look at him and think he's clumsy.
Right.
He wasn't clumsy, man. He'd get around you and all. You'd think he's slow. He wasn't slow either. It's just his body movements and things made him look that way.
That's incredible. That's incredible.
Oh, man. Boy, the man was good. He was good.
Another guy that played for the pros actually in Atlanta was John Drew. There's a guy you don't hear about anymore, but he's sort of a name that doesn't get mentioned in the annals of great basketball players. But Atlanta's got a very rich tradition with sports across the board. Would you say you brought this back to baseball? Had you not left, do you think that you would have had a thriving professional career?
I think I could have made it. I tried out for the Braves right up. So I went to college there in Georgia. And I tried out for the Braves at one time, and they offered me a contract.
Right.
But then I got drafted by Pittsburgh. It went down and played for Pittsburgh instead of Atlanta, and then the strike happened.
Really, it was the strike that kind of derailed things, as you mentioned earlier.
It was. Several good ball players that I knew that I thought was good, they didn't go back either. I guess it just kind of interrupted everything. They figured, well, if I go back, I ain't going to make it now, I'm doing good now, I ain't. So, who knows, sometimes you make a choice that you just got to make a choice on something,
Sure.
What would you say is the toughest choice you ever had to make?
I didn't hear you. It's raining out here. I'm on my porch. It's raining. I didn't hear you.
What would you say was the toughest choice you had to make?
Professionally speaking.
Professionally, of course.
I would think, baseball is. I think baseball is probably one of the hardest to make for me.
Do you still watch the sport, or do you?
I enjoyed wrestling. It was like working out, and taking bumps and doing this and doing that. I enjoyed that. And I picked up quick, of doing things, and I got my body up. You know, when I first started wrestling, I didn't weigh 185 pounds.
Wow.
You know, and then I got up to my best weight was 230, and I was junior champion. I was world champion and United States junior champion. That was my best weight.
Okay.
You know.
You think about again the two
amazing.
The two worlds physically speaking that are apart, baseball and pro wrestling, and just in terms of I guess the workout regimen, or I mean that's just it speaks a lot about your fortitude to move forward and just adapt in a different
right. I know when I worked out as trying in baseball, I worked my traps, my shoulders, and my triceps a lot.
Sure.
Because that's where I could get my swing and my power would come from. But as far as wrestling, you got to look, your whole body's got to look the part.
Right.
You know.
Do you feel, especially this is probably one of the interesting times of wrestling in the mid-80s in terms of just the fans themselves, do you feel like looking back, the kayfabe aspect of it all is something that maybe some of the smart fans subconsciously wish they could be a part of? Because now it's more about digging for information and finding out the news and knowing what the match is going to be about. But if you go to a magic show, you don't really want to know what the magician is going to do. You want to get lost in the performance.
Right. That's right. Same thing. You know, you want to do the same thing in wrestling. You don't want, you know, just throw it out there. They can say what they want to. They can say it's fake. They can say this, it's put on, whatever. Until you've been in there and you took the bumps and you got kicked in the face, in the back, in the stomach, you know, and slammed on a ring that it's just as hard as a floor, you know.
Sure.
Until you took all those bumps and you get up the next day and you can't get up until you roll out of bed and push yourself up because
sure.
You're so sore and you hurt so bad. People don't understand the beating that you do take, your body takes in a wrestling match, especially if it goes a long time. You go out there and wrestle somebody for 5 minutes, I guarantee you won't make 5 minutes.
Right, right.
You know, you got to be in shape to go. Flair was in shape to go an hour every night. You know, and
the
ones that's going to wrestle him and going to be in main events, a tag match would help you, you know, if there's a 45-minute time limit. You wrestle
right.
45 minutes. It would help by, you know, tagging in and out. But when you're by yourself, you know, you got to pace yourself. You know, because you know you're up against the opponent that is tough, and you want to stay in there as long as you can because sometimes you wear people down.
Right.
You know, and they say what they want to, that, hey, they told you to do this, they told you to do that. Most of the time we did what we wanted to do.
Right,
you
right.
Know?
And that's why a lot of the guys who try to call the matches in all their high spots, what they do is invariably if they actually mess up, instead of just realizing that it's improvisation at that point and listening to the crowd – a lot of times you just see them want to get in their spot and put it in anywhere, even if it doesn't make any sense psychologically. And that's
really?
Why a lot of fans just don't remember some of those flips and flops because they don't mean anything.
No, they don't. And that's what hurts. That's what hurts them. That's what hurts the business today.
Right.
Because all they want to do is go out there and go up, down, up, down, up, down. And the people out there are just watching them go up, down, up, down, up, down. You know, they're not screaming. They're not hollering.
No, they're not. No.
You know, I want to beat up the good guy. I got him out there. I want to beat up the good guy. I want to see them holler at me and say, "Oh, you dirty dog, this, that, and the other." Yeah,
of course.
I am. I'm going to kick him again, too.
Of course. How big was the, just I guess, the atmosphere itself? And were you in favor of the unmasking when you were Mr. Olympia? I'm sure the crowd reaction was probably insane at that point.
Oh, yeah. When me and Bob worked the deal where I unmasked, the first time I did, I had a mask underneath.
Right.
Yeah, and nobody knew it. You couldn't tell.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
When I did this, that, and the other, then we came back in another one, and they got the mask off, and we was able to cover myself, you know, pulling me out, and we got myself covered. And then the next one was one of these that I had to unmask and whatever, but that was a little bit down the line. And everybody over there knew me as Jerry Stubbs, too, after all that. So, and then I go to Japan, you know, we do a deal. I go to Japan for 4 weeks, leave, had to be out for whatever, go to Japan and come back and put the mask on because I was a bad guy when I left.
Right.
I come running in as Mr. Olympia and people going nuts.
Right. Right.
You
it's
know?
Interesting how you can kind of, and you talk about two different promotions, obviously, across different sides of the globe. It's interesting how you can kind of parlay a character
right.
differently overseas as you could here. One of the things I find fascinating, too, is Was there discussion in terms of, and then we'll talk about the evolution of the first Mr. Perfect, which was a character that you developed. Was there a point where Kurt Hennig had actually asked you for some advice about the character? You had kind of given him some ideas of how to portray the Mr. Perfect character?
Well, we were in Japan. Me, him, Nelson Roll, a lot of those guys was over there. I think I can't remember all who was there, but we were sitting at a table one night, and we were drinking, and he said, you know, I got to go back. I got to change my stuff up. I said, I'll tell you what, I got something for you. I said, why don't you go back and call yourself Mr. Perfect?
Wow.
You know, I had started it, you know, but I hadn't done a whole lot to it. And I said, hey, go ahead. Call yourself Mr. Perfect. And he sure did. He went back to New York and called himself Kurt Hennig Mr. Perfect.
That's incredible. And, you were still portraying a character that was, you know, similar, confident, overly confident. I mean, there were some, I got to give you credit. You sound humble, so you're not going to take credit for it. But, like, there was some stuff that I think he took. And again, he made it his own, but there was some stuff that he definitely took, I think, from some of your body of work as a compliment. They say, you know, flattery. It's imitation.
Yeah, I told him, I wanted, I said, go back, man, make us a star. I said, I'll be underneath. You just make us a star.
That's incredible.
And, you know, because I didn't care. I didn't, my ego wasn't that big. I policed a lot around, you know. I work for the sheriff's department now. I still work for the sheriff's department.
Sure. Oh, wow.
Yeah, I'm retired, but I work the back and I'm a security guy, and I work the window in the back and let the judges and the lawyers in on Superior Court.
Right.
And I work every other week. I don't work every week, so I'm retired, and that keeps me a little busy and keeps me going, you know, and interested and all. They wanted me to go full time, but I tell them, look, no, I'm 68 years old. I ain't looking to get, the way the world is now about people shooting y'all.
Yeah, but I mean, Jerry, you could walk into the room and put in that Mr. Olympia mask and just patrol again, right? I mean,
yeah.
In all honesty, I completely respect your body of work, and I think it says a lot about the fact that, again, I keep beating this horse to death, but you weren't initially pursuing professional wrestling as a career. So I think the transition from baseball to professional wrestling, just in terms of diet and again everything else, I really have a lot to be completely enamored about in terms of your career. We want to have you on again, but here's one thing I want to always do at the end of our interviews is we play a game of either or. It's pretty self-explanatory, so it's just a game of either or, your preference. We'll start with it, just your preference. Jay Leno or David Letterman?
David Letterman.
Yeah. He was actually also a big pro wrestling fan from Indiana. He was into, like, I mean, the whole Andy Kaufman, Jerry Lawler thing in 82. People forget, before the rock and wrestling and stuff that was going on with Vince, I mean, the Jerry Lawler Kaufman thing was amazing.
Right, right.
And yeah, David Letterman had it there on his show, and he was just all for it.
I like David Letterman. I hate it when he got off the air. He quit, retired.
Yeah, yeah. How about this one, Bugs Bunny or Daffy Duck?
I like Bugs Bunny.
Yeah, people go for Bugs. These two characters, not people, but characters. Al Bundy or Norm from Cheers?
Say it one more time.
Al Bundy or Norm from Cheers?
Al Bundy.
Al Bundy's a classic, isn't he? Yeah, Al Bundy. You can't go wrong with Al Bundy. Gatorade or Powerade?
I still didn't hear it.
Gatorade or Powerade?
I can't hear it too good. Yeah.
No problem. Gatorade or Powerade?
I like Gatorade.
Yeah. Joe Montana or Peyton Manning?
Peyton Manning.
I don't want to get you in trouble here, Jerry. In the looks department, Halle Berry or Angelina Jolie?
Halle Berry.
Yeah. Is that a landslide? Is it close or no?
Close.
Close. Godzilla or King Kong?
King Kong.
Yeah. Bowling or darts?
Who?
Bowling or darts?
I still didn't hear it.
Bowling or darts?
Darts.
You know, the darts is going to the Olympics next year.
Oh, really?
First time, yeah. Yeah.
I got my own dartboard and all. I like to throw darts.
Yeah, darts is a fun game. This might hit close to home with you. Barry Bonds or Wade Boggs?
Ah, that's a close one. I'd have to go with Wade Boggs.
Pete Maravich or Julius Erving?
Pete Maravich.
Yeah. Cujo the dog or Lassie the dog?
Lassie the dog.
Credence Clearwater Revival or Jefferson Airplane?
Credence Clearwater.
This is a tough one. Listening to 8.5 hours of Henry Kissinger doing stand-up comedy or making out with Roseanne for 8 straight minutes?
Ooh, I'd say making out Roseanne.
I think by default, yeah, by default. classic guitar or electric guitar?
Electric guitar.
UFC or boxing?
I didn't hear that one.
UFC or boxing?
I like boxing.
Yeah. Mike Tyson or Muhammad Ali?
Muhammad Ali.
Chuck Norris or Bruce Lee?
Chuck Norris.
Rambo or Rocky?
Rocky.
Richard Pryor or Eddie Murphy?
Richard Pryor.
McDonald's or Burger King?
I like Burger King.
The Whopper, is that what does it?
Yep, the Whopper. Double Whopper.
Much better than a Big Mac, in my opinion. Denny's or Waffle House?
Waffle House.
Especially with that Andre story. I mean, it's classic.
Yeah.
steak or salad?
Steak.
Richard Nixon or Gerald Ford?
Gerald Ford.
Garfield or Heathcliff?
Garfield.
Schwarzenegger or Stallone?
Stallone.
Pens or pencils?
Who what?
Pens or pencils?
Pencils.
I like that. A lot of people don't. I'm an old school guy myself. The thing with a pencil is you can simply erase. I know they have pens that could erase, but hey, I'm a pencil guy.
Right.
Knight Rider or Dukes of Hazzard?
I like Knight Rider.
Isn't it an underrated show? A lot of people don't talk about that as much anymore, right?
Yeah, I think it is, but I like Knight Rider.
Yeah, Knight Rider was great. Star Trek or Star Wars?
Star Wars.
Larry King or Barbara Walters?
Barbara Walters.
Roller coasters or Ferris wheels?
Roller coaster.
Why does nobody like Larry King? Nobody picks Larry King. Nobody. this is an interesting one. Leg day or bicep day? I know, you know, you need them both, but your preference.
Say it one more time.
Leg day or bicep day?
I still didn't understand it.
Leg day or bicep day?
Bicep day.
Horror or comedy?
Comedy.
Stephen King or Steven Spielberg?
Steven Spielberg.
Lynyrd Skynyrd or Led Zeppelin?
Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Rocky or Raging Bull?
Rocky.
Chinese food or Mexican food?
Mexican.
By the way, do you agree that Rocky, in terms of just if you look at Rocky, all the Rockies in general, all of the Rockies were interesting, but Part 4, he actually brings down the Soviet Union by himself.
Right. I watched them all several times.
They were amazing. One of the best face turns was when Apollo turned face.
Mm.
In Rocky 3, he was like a heel the first two, and then he goes face,
right,
and he helps
right.
Rocky out. Yeah, interesting.
Right,
great movies,
right.
Great movies.
Yeah,
Frosted Flakes or Cheerios?
I like Frosted Flakes.
Corvettes or Range Rovers?
What?
A Corvette or a Range Rover?
Oh, I had a Corvette.
Swimming pools or beaches?
Beaches.
Couple more of these. Chips Ahoy cookies or Oreo cookies?
Oreos.
Yeah, Oreos are just classics. Orange juice or grape juice?
Grape juice.
Pepsi or cola, or does it make a difference?
No, don't make a difference.
Road trips or flying?
Flying.
Plums or apples?
Apples.
Okay, I have a question for you. First of all, why do you think plums are so underrated? Have you ever seen a person walking down the street eating a plum? I never have.
No, you don't. But I used to have the biggest, brightest plum tree you ever seen in your life. They had these yellow plums on.
Oh, wow.
And they were so good, man. They were big. They were big as a pecan.
Wow.
You know, and they were good. But you don't see them no more.
You don't see them. You don't see plums. I'm with you.
No, you don't.
It's insane. A favorite animal. Do you have a favorite animal?
Yeah, I got an Irish cream golden retriever.
Wow, great dogs. Mm-hmm. The golden retrievers are my favorites too. This is something I wanted to ask you. If you could be an animal, what animal would it be?
I think I'd be a bear.
Yeah? Is it their hunting skills? But at the same time, they're gentle unless you poke them.
Right. They sleep a lot, too.
Yeah, they do. Ronnie Garvin or One Man Gang?
One Man Gang.
Jerry Lawler or Ric Flair?
Ric Flair.
Bill Watts or Ole Anderson?
Bill Watts.
Ricky Steamboat or Kerry Von Erich?
Ricky Steamboat.
Austin Idol or Roddy Piper?
Roddy Piper.
All Japan, New Japan?
Old Japan.
Hillary Clinton or Missy Hyatt?
Missy Hyatt.
I'm with you there.
She's going to be in Dothan in May, too, with us.
Oh, she will be on that fan fest.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Yep.
Diners or cafes?
Cafe.
Movie theaters or Netflix?
Netflix.
The Beatles or Elvis?
The oldest.
French fries or onion rings?
Both.
Okay. This is sort of a little interesting little game. Assuming these were shoot fights, assuming they were real shoot fights, and again, by the way, with pro wrestling, what you guys have done is, to me, one of the most respectful things in the world. The bumps you took, the injuries, the tolls, it doesn't get more real than that, and I respect that. But if these following matches were shoot style, who would win? Triple threat. Dracula, Wolfman, or Frankenstein?
I'd say Frankenstein.
He's just hard to, like, put down, I guess, right? He's a big guy.
Right.
Abe Lincoln, George Washington, or Jesse Ventura?
Jesse Ventura.
Roseanne Barr, Rosie O'Donnell, or Melissa McCarthy? That's a lot of weight there in that match.
I think Rosie O'Donnell.
Yeah, she's kind of mean. How about this one? Alf, the alien from Aliens, or Spock?
Spock.
Yeah, Spock's a smart guy. Freddy Krueger, Michael Myers, or Jason from Friday the 13th, the day that you were born, Friday the 13th.
Oh, I like Jason.
Yeah, it's got a birthday there. Scooby-Doo, Lassie, or Old Yeller?
I like Old Yeller. That's a whole one.
He's an old one. Fred Flintstone, Ralph Cramden from The Honeymooners, or Archie Bunker?
Archie Bunker.
Archie didn't take any crap.
No.
Archie didn't take any crap. And here's the last one I have here. Actually, two more. Barbara Streisand, Celine Dion, or Dolly Parton?
Dolly Parton.
Yeah, she has a secret weapon there.
Yeah.
Sam Kinison, John Candy, or Chris Farley?
Kennedy.
Yeah. Most likely to say, people you worked with in the past, colleagues, most likely to tell you, hey, stop, I'm hungry, during a road trip.
God, that's hard to say.
Andre, maybe?
I'm trying to think. Andre? Yeah, it had to be Andre.
Most likely to say, maybe this is half the locker room, I don't know, but most likely to say, hey, do my biceps look small today?
Austin Allen.
Yeah. Most likely to read a book quietly in a locker room?
I didn't. That'd be kind of, maybe wrestling too.
Okay. Most likely to crack jokes in the middle of the ring during a match?
Let me see. It was two brothers that went as brothers, and they both had like little peroxide in the front of their hair.
Right. The multis,
rock,
maybe?
Rock, let's see. What was Sputniks,
oh, okay.
Brothers. Remember those?
Yeah.
They would do it right in the middle of the ring.
Would you? In all honesty, though, are you the type of guy would you kind of like maintain yourself? You almost have to, but even when you didn't have a mask, how did you feel about that stuff? Was it all in jest and fun, or were you like really into your character and you kind of didn't prefer all that messing around?
I was kind of into it, you know.
Yeah.
I like to play the part, you know, being a little mysterious and all this, that, and the other. You know, trying to make people guess who it might
sure.
be. You know, it's intriguing. Intriguing, wearing a mask is intriguing to everybody.
Right.
Because it's just something. It's almost like little guy, that guy wears the Spider-Man suit.
Right,
I mean,
right.
It's just intriguing to them people. Batman and Spider-Man and people like that.
Sure.
People just, they put themselves as, that's a character. You might think we're cartoon characters, but it's something that they identify and they enjoy. They love it.
Right, right. And I think that's why appearance matters so much in pro wrestling, because in essence, you don't want to look at somebody, and this is just my opinion, I could be wrong. Sometimes you want to see somebody that looks like you so you can say you can make it. But if you're just looking at it as a fan, you want to look at somebody that you know is nothing like you and you look at as a hero, someone that's
right.
You want that.
Somebody, right, yeah. Somebody you look up to.
Yeah.
I was the same way when I was growing up. You know, I had the same thing. Baseball players, Hank Aaron, this, that, the other.
Sure.
You know, I was intrigued to watch them. It used to be the Dodgers and the Yankees always in the World Series.
Right.
Way back
yeah.
when I was growing up. You know, Don Dryden.
Did you, just through radio, were you into like a lot of those World Series the Yanks were in the early 60s?
Yes.
And, yeah.
Yes, sure was.
We just talked to Bobby Fulton, and we did our opening there, and it's one of those interesting times where just in terms of all the sports, it was great to see them grow. I mean, baseball, basketball, professional wrestling as well. I mean, you lived through some of the best times. I mean, I have to say, most likely to also be someone you still call a friend in the industry today.
Ted DiBiase, all the guys that that we stay in touch, because we have a reunion that we go to every year in Mobile. We didn't go this year. And then we have one out in Las Vegas that we go to, and so on. And there's a lot of wrestlers that go, a lot of older wrestlers that go.
Sure.
That you hadn't seen, and we all, you know, love seeing each other and all that, tell stories of what we've been doing now, and so on and so on. And just meet and greet each other again, you know, and every year we lose some, you know.
Which is a shame. I mean, that's the aspect about it. Was there one particular death, and we could never put them in one box, but was there one death that kind of like sort of hit you really hard, more, you know, just sort of pulled at your heartstrings?
Yeah, Skandal Akbar did, you know.
Yeah.
I saw him at one of the reunions, and he went home. Next thing you know, he was dead.
Incredible. That's
just... You see them, and then they go, and then, hey, so-and-so passed away, so-and-so passed away.
Same.
You know?
You just saw them like the day before, yeah. Wow.
It's like taking a piece away from you, you know?
Sure. It's really sad. Ted DiBiase is an inspirational figure where a lot of people, I mean, he really lays it all out when if you hear him speak and just a lot of the things he speaks about that he went through. He doesn't really, he's not, what you see is what you get, sure, but at the same time, he goes in-depth about his trials and tribulations, which I find fascinating.
Right. Yeah, Ted was a good guy, man. He helped me a lot. We travel a lot. We stayed at hotels together. You know, we'd get a double room and whatever, and we'd stay together. Junkyard Dog, me and him, a lot of times.
Sure.
You're with them more than you with your family, and you grow up, and they grow kind of on you like brothers. You
That's
know?
Such a good point, though. That's such a good point. I mean, how about Orndorff? Was he sort of more to himself a little bit over there in Mid-South?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, it's funny because it's one of those situations where because you don't see your family, but at the same time, talk about a catch-22, you're providing for them at the same time.
Right.
Well,
and
I
think somebody that's hard to get along with for other people, but not for me, was Mr. Wrestling, too.
Right.
He didn't take up with many people, and he didn't offer his opinion to nobody. And he didn't help many people, but he helped me and he helped Randy Rose.
Do you think it's because he saw that you're respectful, humble, and you're a straight shooter? Is that what kind of...
Yeah, I think so. And we would travel. He wouldn't travel. He'd travel by himself or he'd travel with people. But he'd always say, hey, you guys want to ride with me? Or I said, well, let me drive this time, you know, so on. And he wouldn't ask nobody else. I don't know if many people had ever rode with wrestling, too, except me and Randy.
Sure. That is a rarity. I mean, another guy that sticks out to me that's very underrated is Matt Bourne. There's a guy that doesn't get mentioned enough.
Matt Bourne, yeah. He was over in the territory with us and Bill Watts.
Yeah, I mean, it's just
Matt,
Wow.
Matt was a good guy. He was a real good guy. A lot of people,
sure.
A lot of people thought he was his attitude problem, had an attitude problem, thought
right.
he was better than everybody else. But I didn't.
Right.
DiBiase didn't. We all got together, got along good. You know,
it was just such a great group, and I think that's what I feel a lot of fans are missing, in the sense that they look back at those days and they say to themselves, wait a minute, I had a conversation with someone I knew. And before I actually delve into that, I want to make a quick announcement here. We do want to mention something interesting regarding Right Guard. We have something that we're going to say, but not in this particular interview, but we do want to thank them for their support. We have an announcement to make as soon as we find out, but we do want to thank Right Guard.
I thank them because I use them.
Oh, there you go.
I use Right Guard. You know,
there you
I
go.
Use Right Guard for many, many years.
Yeah, it gets the way to go. I mean, it really is. Definitely, anyone in athletics knows that. Now, the interesting thing I have to delve into as far as what we were talking about is, I think the conversation I had, it was actually with a news analyst, and he's a pretty pro wrestling fan. He does a lot of, he's an anchor. And one of the things he brought up to me was the fact that he feels that he can't quite put his finger on why this big nostalgia in terms of some of the wrestlers that, in my opinion, I think it's because when we're watching pro wrestling today, we see a bunch of kids, which are, don't get me wrong, they're athletic and they have a lot of talent. But when we look at the 80s and we see the professional wrestlers that went up and down the roads and did the territories, we were looking at men. We were looking at legitimate
right.
men.
Right.
These right. guys we see that are, you talk about the Norse gods, you talk about comic book heroes, you're looking at real men that were putting their life on the line. They weren't just trying to do this acrobatic gymnastic stuff, to get a cheap pop. They were literally, you guys were literally carrying each other like brothers on the road and in the ring. And it resonated.
Right.
It resonated to the fan base.
Oh, right. Yes, it did. Yes, it did. And we were hard workers, you know. We tried to please the crowd. The bad guys tried to disrupt the crowd, and the good guys tried to please the crowd. So, and that's what made it. I mean, there's a good and a bad. It's just, you know, today you watch wrestling on there. There's not much of a good guy and a bad guy. It's just spots.
That's it.
You yeah. know, they're not drawing that picture. You know, when I got a guy down and I start beating on him, I'm going to kick him down. I'm going to get my share.
Of course.
You know,
people
holler all they want. I don't want them to holler. I want you to scream and holler.
You want a good example? My co-host here who's on the line, Dave, he's one of the most intelligent people I know. He could do everything in the world and not even talk about it because he's humble. But this is a guy who was very interested in the pro wrestling game. He's kind of turned off by it a bit now. Is that the case, Dave? Do you feel like right now it's just there's nothing to pull you in, right? Is that
yeah?
Right.
I feel like the wrestlers are more into getting the spotlight. It's more business than passion.
Right.
I see everybody's just most interested in posting pictures on Facebook, Instagram about every moment
right.
of their life instead of focusing
right.
on the real passion, which is wrestling. And that actually takes me a little bit away from wrestling. And that's why I enjoyed watching wrestling more in the 80s and 90s when I was growing up, compared to today.
You got to get out there and you got to show the crowd something, you know. You got a good guy and a bad guy, and you
yeah.
got a story between them both. Something's happened somewhere between them. And,
sure.
you know, they're going to fight it out till the end and so on, and then go on to somebody else. But and sometimes, like, I had runs with Bob Armstrong.
Right.
I mean, year runs. And
sure.
and so on. And it was just, people loved it. I said, man, I want to go see that. You know, I want to go see Stubbs and Armstrong again, or Mr. Lincoln and Armstrong again. Hey, because they tear it up, boy. You know.
Is there a place, Jerry, that's like on your bucket list in terms of travel that you would like to go to that you haven't went to?
No, I've been to Australia, I've been to Japan, and we go to a couple cruises every year. And,
right.
you know, out in Bahamas and otherwise. We're going on in July, going down to Key West and Freeport.
Wow. Yeah.
Several
okay.
more. We're going to be gone 7 days.
I met a
bunch of people that I met in Louisiana that were fans. And
Look
we stayed
that.
In touch, and some of them are in Mobile, and some of them in Louisiana. We're going out of New Orleans, so.
See, that's neat. When you hear stuff like that, it's just, it's so neat to be able to see that community. Some of the fans are pro wrestling fans, not only are some of the most passionate, but in terms of loyal, they're loyal to
yeah.
you. I mean, to,
right.
like you mentioned, people who still write you. Is there, and this is something just out of curiosity, in terms of just, it doesn't have to be related to pro wrestling, or it can be, it doesn't matter, but favorite vacation that sticks out? Do you have a vacation that you always look back and go, man, that was one great vacation I took?
Well, back then you didn't get many vacations. Of course, we lived in Pensacola. It was like,
but I guess, I mean, just over your whole life in general. Just, in, you know, is there a vacation that you kind of look at and you go, wow, man, I'd like to have that week back.
Yeah. A couple of Panama City trips.
Right.
Daytona trips. You know.
Right.
Like that. I wish I had some of them back, you know.
Sure.
But, shoot, I love my vacations. We take these cruises. I was going to tell you about this Louisiana and,
right,
and Mobile people. They were just wrestling fans. We got about 30 already on this cruise. And and I'll take a mask. I'll take a mask, and we'll have a day that we all have. We're all around somewhere around the pool or whatever, and I'll put it on, and they all want pictures made. And people, sometimes we got a crowd of 100 or so.
Right.
I mean, they're coming by, you know, people say, hey, you need to go up there. So, and some of them say, man, I used to see you on such and such.
Sure.
You know, you'd be surprised how many, a lot of people back then wouldn't tell you they watched wrestling.
Right.
But you let something happen good, and they'll be the first to tell you about it.
What, before we actually, we would love to have you back. Before we sign off here, I'd like to turn over to Dave, and please, anything you'd like to ask Jerry, I turn this corner over to you.
Yeah, absolutely. I actually wanted to ask you an important question. Like, growing up in the 70s, 80s, and you remember how the youth was back then, how women were back then. How do you think it's very different compared to today?
Society, right? Yeah.
I don't think they some of them do, but the majority don't keep their body where they should keep it. You got thin, skinny guys out there that's wiry and takes all these bumps and do all this other stuff, never sell a thing, but they just don't look the part, you know?
Right, yeah.
You got to at least look the part, in my opinion, you know?
I agree with you. You have to be slow. I mean, that's the presentation part of it. I agree with you.
Right.
What future?
If you don't look the part, I can't get into those guys that just get out there and all they're going to do is high spots for 10 minutes. They've done everybody's finish and everything, and nobody got hurt.
Jerry, life in general, do you think the PC movement has gone, I personally think it's gone too, do you think the PC movement has gone a bit too far, just in general? The PC police, I like to call them, I mean.
Yeah, they have.
Yeah,
they have.
Even me with teaching, it's, I remember talking about certain things, I'd bring up Lyndon B. Johnson and talk about how he pushed forth the civil rights movement, and it's, you can't, you'd be surprised how many things there are mandates against bringing up certain things, because if you don't follow that lesson plan to a T, and God forbid, give an opinion.
Right.
I remember during the McCain-Obama elections, I would switch their policies over, and I would put McCain's policies under Obama's name and Obama's policies under McCain's name, and my students would walk in, and I would tell them, which policies do you guys think are great? And sure enough, they'd pick Obama, and I said, guess what? You just picked McCain's policies.
Uh-huh.
It's a popularity contest.
That's the way it is.
Yep.
They don't go with reality stuff. They go with pretend that they know. You know.
And
they don't know. They really don't know.
No.
And they've never had anybody really teach them. All they played is, I want to be a professional wrestler. And they get up in the ring, and they get some tights and stuff, and they think they're a wrestler.
Yeah, like they have maybe 20 matches in about 10 years, and they call themselves wrestlers.
Right.
I'm with you.
Yeah. You're absolutely right, man.
It is what it is. In closing, it's my opinion that great conversation is one thing. Great conversation with a human being that exceeds and epitomizes the word class is another thing. A lot of people complain, and maybe they'll start talking about how they have the case of the Mondays. But I'd like to say that, in my opinion, this Monday turned out to be pretty damn good, because we talked to a gentleman, an honest individual, a humble individual, Jerry Stubbs. I'd like to turn it over to you, Jerry. Anything you want to say to the fans or just in general, I want to turn the corner over to you.
Well, I just like to tell them all, anybody that's listening, all my fans, or even the ones that weren't my fans, I appreciate you coming and watching. I appreciate you coming and hollering. And I hope I made your day in some part of the wrestling business.
Absolutely. And I know you did.
Absolutely. Loved it.
On behalf of David,
I'm still trying to make
it. And that's the thing, too. Yeah, can you bring this up again? Because a lot of times during the end of an interview, I definitely want to sort of let fans know that as Jerry mentioned earlier, if you didn't hear it, there is some stuff coming down there, coming down the pike. If you want to bring it up again, feel free, Jerry.
Yeah, I'm going to be in Dothan, Alabama on May the 11th down in there, and we've got two or three shows. We got a fan fest where we're going to have Abdullah the Butcher. We're going to have Jake the Snake, Missy Hyatt. We're going to have several wrestlers down there. I'll be down there. But we sign autographs, take pictures. And then there's also wrestling matches at the end. So you'll get all of everything, and you will certainly enjoy it. And I'm also
sounds like a great experience. You guys should check this out. Definitely.
Yeah. And then I'm in Decatur, Tennessee on the 27th at Meigs High School. It's a benefit for, I think they said, for the football team.
Right.
But I get them all the time. I turn them down. I turn down more than I go to because it's just, you know, being close to 70 years old now, I just can't get out there and drive as far.
God bless you,
know,
of course. If it makes you feel better, I'm not even 40 and I can't really drive that much. I get tired.
So. Yeah, I always stop 40 again and know what I know now.
Yeah, but you know what? You've enlightened us and you've enlightened our listeners, and we'd love to have you again if you'd like to come on.
Sure. Anytime. You just let me know.
On behalf of David Benedetti, I'd like to thank Jerry Stubbs. This has been the Wrestling with Anything But.